Welcome to r/RedditRevenge. This is a story of someone getting back at someone with revenge, after being wronged. And today we have three great stories, so subscribe, hit the like button, and let's begin. The first story, uncle and aunt combination try to intentionally lose me in big city. They get disowned and publicly shamed when I expose a property stealing scheme a few years later. The second story, lady tries to take away profits from an animal aid and relief organization, gets sued. The third story, a-holes are scamming potential hires for fake reviews. And the first story is, try to get rid of me in an overseas big city? We'll get rid of you instead. Context. Back in 2011, me and my immediate family traveled to Saudi Arabia for Umrah, or what's known as the Lesser Pilgrimage. You visit Mecca, make rounds around the Kaaba, pray with all your heart and soul, you get the picture. My dad and I were excited because we were all about going on a spiritual journey and casting away the problems of the world. But as it turns out, some problems just wouldn't leave us. As soon as we landed in Jeddah's airport, our plan was to take a taxi to Mecca and get the Umrah done while we were still gung-ho about God. However, we were instead diverted to our relative's house in Jeddah, where we discovered that four or five of my mother's relatives and their families had gathered up and spontaneously crashed in my grandfather's house for one giant family reunion. Naturally, my dad and I, as well as my maternal grandfather, were really upset over this development, as my mom's side of the family is full of, for the lack of a more polite word, the shady folks. Most of them I was on good terms with, but once I realized that my least favorite uncle and aunt had come with the crew, my enthusiasm just deflated like a balloon. For a quick comparison, Uncle Zubair and Aunt Rubina were the Uncle Vernon and Aunt Petunia of the family to me. They'd spoil their own kids rotten, be as stingy as they could be with me before getting noticed, and oh, did they love to take advantage of the fact that I couldn't speak Urdu at all when I was younger. They talked smack about me and made fun of me for all sorts of things, and when my mother brought it up, they simply waved it off as me misunderstanding whatever they said in Urdu, and my mother trusted them. Sure, I couldn't speak the language well when I was 8, but I could well understand a lot of what they were saying, and just going through all of that really made me intensely dislike them. Back to 2011. The entire rodeo of relatives comes up with a great plan. Let's go complete our Umrah trip as a group of 23 people. It'll be a great time. Me and my father reluctantly agree to this, and before we head to Mecca, my father makes a little contingency plan for the rare occasion me or my siblings get lost. My mother shares it with the group, and everyone thinks it's a good idea. If someone gets lost, we all return to IEX floor of the clock tower building and wait for the rest to come. No problems, right? We go to Mecca, we have dinner in the clock tower hotel, and as I'm getting napkins to clean up after the food, the men split up and abruptly leave for the Kaaba. The ladies already had left, and Aunt Rubina still at the table waiting on the napkins. When I ask her where all the men went, she smiles and points in the wrong direction, and also tells me twice that our contingency plan got changed, and we were to meet on Y floor if we got lost, instead of the original contingency plan. Had I been older, I would have noticed something was very wrong with her words, but I was 15 years old and fearful of being left behind, and so I ran off without even doubting her. The result of her misleading me amounted to 1 hour of checking out the entire hotel looking for my father and the men, then heading out to the Kaaba and spending 3 hours circling the Kaaba, distracted and heavily disturbed by the fact that I couldn't find them anywhere, and then heading back to the new contingency plan's location and crying myself to sleep on a rusty chair because none of the guards understood me, and I honestly thought I was lost for good. A couple hours later, my father finds me, and he gets violently mad at me for ditching the group and going to the wrong floor, but he realizes something's up as soon as I tell him what Aunt Rubina told me. The men quickly arrive and hug me out, and when Uncle Zubair hugs me, he grins and asks me, "Did you feel the despair?" Before laughing it off as I take the next minute to process this man's words. The entire group of 23s just trying to talk to me and see the positives out of the situation on the car ride back, but the whole time I just have one thought on my mind. Did my uncle and aunt really just try to intentionally mislead me and lose me in a large city overseas? I later tell my parents the whole story. My father's a little bit unsettled, and the rest of the trip continues with my parents keeping a close eye on me. Revenge. Back in 2015, we visited the homeland and met up with all these bozos who were excited to see my mom's Amra Khan family, and just as expected, Uncle Zubair and Aunt Rubina are in the mix. I decided not to say anything about what happened 4 years prior, and I make my mom promise not to say anything about the incident, so she loves to reminisce things. About an hour into the trip, I realized that my uncle and aunt still think I have the same language comprehension I had when I was 8 years old. Amazing how they think I'm so stupid. But in 2015, I was finally able to speak and understand Urdu fluently, but I wasn't just gonna tell them that. With that, I decided that I'd snoop around, and maybe sit through their SH again with a recorder, and show my mom that I was right all along, about them lying to my mom that they weren't SH talking me. But this is where things get interesting. Uncle Zubair takes me along with his son, as we visit a couple different apartment and houses he has the keys for, and help him clean out the houses. My neighbors are out on vacation, and they asked if I could help clean up for them. He tells me in his broken English, but I really doubt him between how fervently he's scouring the entire place, and how he's indiscriminately throwing their belongings in giant trash bags and large rubber containers. Belongings of neighbors that apparently trusted him enough to leave their spare keys with him, as they stayed with relatives in America or elsewhere for the summer. It was weird and shady AF. I'd never seen anything like this back in the States, but I connected the dots when on another day, Uncle Zubair's son called me from one of the said apartments and asked me if I could walk over there and pick him up. Turns out the house was almost entirely empty of anything the neighbors owned, and my cousin already set a bunch of his own stuff in there, and had the gall to tell me, "Papa, this is my apartment now." What a riot. My uncle was robbing people of their apartments and houses when they were on vacation. A week later of some unnoticed eavesdropping, and I learned that Aunt Rubina and my other cousin are doing the same dirty work in the state and province right next to ours. They had better English, and told me that they were going to the other state to help my cousin study, and I was just nodding it off. Yeah, go study your lying A off, as if I didn't hear you at all 24 hours ago talking about cleaning house preparations. We're having dinner later that night with Uncle Zubair, and a few other family members, and when there's a lull in the conversation, he just asked me, "Son, what's your favorite part of the summer so far?" And I just smiled and replied in Urdu, "I love the real estate work you've been doing. Could you help me get a property as well?" His face just drains the moment he realizes I knew the SH he's been pulling, and everyone at the table starts asking questions, because my uncle is the last guy to talk about house-related matters. They prompt me for more information, and I just spill what his son said. "Papa said this is my apartment now," and what type of BS he and his wife were doing five towns over, and the next thing I know I'm taking my dinner plate back to my room, as the drilling commences in the dining room. As my family and the rest of the extended relatives finds out, he's been clearing out apartments of neighbors who went overseas for the entire summer, maybe 10 or so such flats and little houses, and hauling their possession to a storage unit somewhere only God knows. The controversy gets really big, a couple homeowners get alerted, and chase Aunt Rubina and my cousin out of other town. And it's not long before my parents told me that our entire family pretty much disowned my uncle and aunt's family for pulling this immoral BS when being trusted with people's keys. In the end, I never was able to stick him with the "did you feel despair" line he hit me with back in 2011, but man am I glad I won't have to deal with their SH again. The next story is, take away profits from an animal aid organization. Good idea. After months of stress and struggle, my mom told me of a wonderful resolution to a story I knew all too well. And it would be a sin not to post it here. Here's the cast. Names changed. Tess, my mom. Karen, event planner, worthy victim of ProRevenge. John, Tess's lawyer. For context, Tess is the vice president of a prominent nonprofit organization, which we'll call HC for the sake of simplicity, whose main focus is to aid and protect pets, as well as improve the situation of animals with no home. Karen worked for HC under the role of an event planner, and one of the events that the entire board of HC, as well as Karen, had come up with was a fashion show. The event name must remain anonymous for reasons later revealed, but the main idea was that all the proceeds of the fashion show would go towards HC's animal relief provisions. After the event was set in stone months in advance, Karen quit for reasons unknown, and instead joined a competing and less humane animal organization. Here's where the problem arose. Karen began advertising HC's event name all over social media, but changed many essential details. She changed the date, time, and that the proceeds would go towards the place of her new employment. Little did she know, using the same name would not only cause much confusion among attendees, taking away HC's much-needed profit, but as everyone would later discover, it was also completely illegal. Tess reached out to Karen in a polite email, asking her to simply change the name of the event she was hosting for the competing organization, explaining that it would be harmful to the profit of HC's event. Karen flipped. She responded back to Tess saying that she would not change the event name under any circumstances. Karen posted all over social media, saying that HC was a corrupt organization, and that she hopes no one will attend the event of such a disgusting organization. She also thought it would be appropriate to reach out to the place hosting HC's event, and tell them to cancel HC's event, and instead host her company's event. They, of course, refused. Tess had come home many nights crying, upset that something as trivial as this was going to, in the long run, take away valuable profit from HC, and the animals they're attempting to relieve. The publicity alone that Karen had attracted would bring irreparable damage. So after much consideration and counsel with her board members, Tess reached out to her organization's lawyer, John. ProRevenge time. John reaches out to Karen and her organization in an email, detailing that what she was doing was unlawful, and if she refused to comply with HC's request, she'd be sued for her damages. Apparently, even if she did have a hand in coming up with the event, she was under the employment of HC when it was created, and being an employee, all the intellectual property rights went to HC by default. This was actually detailed in terms of general employment agreements, but I suppose that one more person who failed to read the terms and conditions. This time, Karen took it up a level of immaturity, responding to John in a nasty and disrespectful email, maintaining her new routine of attacking HC on social media, but this time she got many of her coworkers and friends to as well. So what was Tess and John's response to this? They sued. Court day comes, and I'll spare all the lengthy legal details, but Karen came out with two choices. 1. File for bankruptcy. Or 2. Post an apology in a statement that HC was in the right, and that she fully supports them, that they get all rights to the event, and that she must sell $300,000 worth of tickets over the next 2 years. It's an annual event. A disgruntled and hesitant Karen chose door number 2. As of now, John and Karen are collaborating on a public apology, and she's got a hell of a lot of tickets left to sell. The last story is, restaurant scams me for fake Google reviews. I burn their Google reviews page and reputation to the ground, and get the media to cover it. So about a month ago, I applied for a sushi restaurant called Yoshi's, and I got a text from their hiring manager, and we chatted about my availability, location, start date, yada yada. She then asked me to write a review of general Japanese food to show I knew what I was talking about and could upsell customers. Fine, I write a long review and send it to her. She then sends me a tiny link URL and tells me to post it there before I would be invited for an interview. I click it and what do you know, it's the Google page for a whole different restaurant all the way across the city. So I read the reviews, and they had done this to 30 or so people in the last 2 weeks, at the different locations franchised to the same crazy owner. I was peeved to say the least. This happened peak COVID in my state. People are unemployed at staggering rates struggling to feed their families, and these a-holes are scamming potential hires for fake reviews. I was boiling, hopping mad. The lady that texted me as the hiring manager asked me what she could do to fix it after I called her out, which made me even angrier. Like, how about not being a scumbag and scamming people? Being unemployed, I had some time on my hands, so I screenshotted our convo and posted it all over social media. They went from 3.4 to 1.2 in a few hours, with more than 70 new reviews about their SH behavior. I was satisfied with that, and a report to the Attorney General here. But then I noticed the owner had managed to get all the reviews removed, so that at that point I went full nuclear. I contacted every media outlet, reported them to every oversight board, emailed corporate about it, and reported them to Google. I managed to get one of our local news outlets to cover it, and Google ended up removing all their reviews altogether. Scam me and countless others during a global pandemic? I ruin your business's reputation for your SH behavior. I hope you enjoyed those stories. Don't forget to subscribe.